Theory?
This is how are we going to make a change in? Now we know that energy is energy and that we can really measure it with the change in temperature as far as we do make sense. So experimentally, we can perform a chemical reaction and we can measure the change in temperature. To do this, we need to use a piece of equipment called a calorimeter. And the calorimeter, that comes from calorie, and calorie being a way of measuring the energy, as well as chemicals. Now, what we're going to do today is just a regular calorimeter, if you like, and then there is another kind of piece of equipment we can use, which is called the bomb calorimeter. It doesn't explode, it just looks a bit like a bomb. But we're not going to worry about that one. We're going to be interested in this one today. And then the other ways that we can do it are using Hess's law, which I won't cover today. And then the last one is by just using the bomb energies, which have been experimentally determined by somebody else. Okay, so this one is just a pure calculation, as is this one, whereas the first method is by performing an experiment and making measurements. But if you turn the page, see here, so it talks about method one. This is method one. Two sub methods. There's this whole page of food and nutritional information that has come off some packagings. So we're quite familiar with looking at a label. Perhaps you are, you buy some food, and you look at the label, you find this nutritional panel. And it will have the energy in the food listed, and it will generally quote that energy in kilojoules. Kilojoules can be calories, but kilojoules are more common in Australia because joules are the SI unit of energy. And what does it really mean? What does that mean? When we eat that food, just say that one that's circled that says it's got 870 kilojoules, what does that mean in terms of chemistry? Because if they listed the amount of energy that you needed, your body needed to put into digesting that food, then food that had a very high energy rating on the side, like say chocolate or like Mars, you would actually lose weight, wouldn't you, eating them? But that doesn't happen. So this is the amount of energy that is available to your body. Yes, and we know that energy is required to break bonds, and then energy is released when the bonds form. So the difference here is that energy is being released as these new bonds form, and so these ones must be exothermic reactions, mustn't they? Because during their bond formation, we've got what energy being produced as well. So let's have a look here, and one thing that we need to know, I guess, with our experiments here, is how do we measure the change in temperature? And it's the change in temperature of what? Well, the what is water. Compare that to ammonia and ethanol, aluminium, etc. All of those other specific heat capacities in the table on page 15 are much lower, with ethanol being around half the specific heat capacity of water. This is why you have a radiator filled with water to cool your internal combustion engine in your car. Water is the preferred cooler because it has this high specific heat capacity. So it has this capacity to not boil if it gets really, if we can add a lot of energy and it's not going to boil. Very useful property. Nuclear reactor, underwater, same reason. Plenty of times we're using this property of water without really thinking about it. And the only place where you might not use water in your radiator would be parts of your planet where you freeze. Then you would have to change over to like black coal or something like that. Have a lot of antifreeze in your radiator, but if you're not living in that part of the planet, everyone's got water in their radiator. You might have a rust inhibitor. That would be the only other thing. Okay, so how do we go about doing our calculations? We've got an example on page 16. We want to calculate the energy required to be 120 kilowatts. Now, I didn't really focus on this. This is a massively water. Grams, because with chemistry we're normally measuring our masses in grams. So if you look then at this sample calculation, you've got 120 mils of water That means I've got 120 grams. And I want to raise it from delta T. I want to raise it from 25 degrees to 100 degrees. Yeah, it doesn't matter if it's Celsius or Kelvin, as we know, that the size of the increment is going to be the same. In this case, with our gases calculations, we had to be working in Kelvin, but we don't have to be working in Kelvin here. We just have to be aware of what each of those mean. And then we have our specific heat capacity of water. Also notice on your formula sheets you have a new equation where H is equal to mc delta T. H here is the enthalpy. We already know we've been using the symbol before, but we haven't been doing much in the way of calculations. So it's our mass of our water times our specific heat capacity times our change in temperature. Us 37656 joules. Right? You look at the units that we used, multiply the grams by grams to minus one, and multiply the temperature by the temperature to minus one. So all we're left with then is joules. But it's quite common practice to express our answers in kilojoules. So here we've got temperatures to 2 sig figs, and so our answer would be to 2 sig figs. Got any questions about that?